All right, I want to follow up with the lesson we did on Article 3, where we highlighted and kind of looked at what specifically is in the Constitution when it comes to the judiciary. And so we're going to have three cards, so grab three. That's not very long, but we just want to get some highlights here from what we did. All right, so first off, 2.55 Article 3, just some generic aspects of it. One, judicial power is vested in the Supreme Court. You notice that they use that phrase a lot, vested in, legislative power shall be vested in a Congress, shall be vested in a president. Congress can make inferior courts. Remember, inferior courts are the courts below the Supreme Court. So underline that word. That means they have to rule, again, consistent with what the Supreme Court has ruled on an issue. So just to remind yourself, inferior courts are federal courts below SCOTUS, below the Supreme Court. And one of the things that Congress has also control over is they control jurisdiction and they control the number of judges and courts and whatnot. So they can expand the judiciary. They can make it smaller. They could change the number of justices on the Supreme Court, which they've done in the past. Right now there are 9. They could make it 5. They could go up to 15. Congress can do that. Congress has that power. All right, and remember also that you hold office when you're in a, when you're a judge in the federal system, according to the Constitution, you will hold it for good behavior, which means a life tenure. And we'll look at why life tenure was what they chose in Federalist 78. All right, 2.56, Article 3, Supreme Court jurisdiction. So this is a little bit longer to write. And if you want to just write SCOTUS jurisdiction, that'd be good. All right, that's our abbreviation, 2.56. And remember, jurisdiction is, I'm going to define it first. We've already, I think, have a card on it, so you don't have to rewrite the definition, but just a reminder, jurisdiction is the power to make legal decisions. So like you have the right by law to decide this. And remember, if you go to a traffic court, they don't have the right to rule whether or not you had your free speech violated by me at the court, at school. You don't have that right to do it in a traffic court. Traffic court has jurisdiction over traffic matters. All right, so what does the Supreme Court have the right to rule on? One, constitutional issues. Constitutional issues. Two, U.S. laws, meaning federal law. They could rule on a state law if the state law somehow contradicts a federal or constitutional issue, potentially. Treaties. That has international impact, obviously. Maritime issues, meaning things dealing with water, like fishing rights off the coast of Maine, or perhaps two states arguing over river rights. Cases with the U.S. as a party. So you sue the United States government, then it would be a case that could go to the Supreme Court eventually. It would go to lower court first. Cases with two or more states. New York sues New Jersey over navigation rights of a river or something. All right, now the last two are what we call original jurisdiction, and that means the Supreme Court would hear the case first. Normally, all the cases that I just listed, those would actually go to a lower court first, district court. The trial would be held at the district court. That's where the trial would be held. And then it would be appealed to the circuit court or the U.S. appeals courts, as they're called, and then it would be appealed to the Supreme Court. There is not a trial at the appeals court level or the Supreme Court level. They just hear the lawyers for 30 minutes, and then they make a decision on it, a ruling. Matter of fact, appeals courts don't even usually have trials, but the Supreme Court would not even have hearings. The Supreme Court, though, will have hearings. All right, so what we're talking about now is original jurisdiction. That means the Supreme Court would hear a trial. All right, if it has to do with an ambassador or some minister from a foreign country or a foreign ambassador or anything like that, that would have original jurisdiction. So the Supreme Court would hear that first. They don't have to, by the way. They actually can farm it out to somebody else, some lower courts. They can give it to them or a judicial group from some different circuit courts or whatever. They can actually hand it on. Most of the time they do. All right. And the last one, which maybe is hard to read, is U.S. versus a state. U.S. versus a state. And by the way, that's also just says original jurisdiction. If you just want to write original and put that in parentheses, that's fine. At this point, you should know that jurisdiction is the word after it, since the freaking card is jurisdiction, right? Okay, cool. One last thing. So we're going to go to the last card. Grab it. All right. In 2.57, Article 3, criminal trials. So Article 3 had a little section there about criminal trials. I want to talk about that really fast. Criminal trials must be by jury. Interestingly, this is kind of repeated in the Bill of Rights. There is an exception, though, to jury trial, except in impeachment. And remember, impeachment is the trial for the impeachment is done in the Senate, which it really isn't a jury because it's like political. And it has to be held in the state where the crime happened. It's done in the state where the crime happened. And one last thing about this. The president cannot pardon impeached officials. So that says pardon, by the way. Pardon me for covering it up. Sorry. All right. So the president cannot pardon impeached officials. This is why President Nixon was pardoned by President Ford prior to him actually being having to go to court. Or actually, Nixon resigned before he got impeached, so that way he could be pardoned. That's what I was trying to say. All right, cool. All right, awesome. That's the three cards. And next we're going to be doing Federal 78, which is awesome. So we'll see you then. Bye.